Ganesh Chowk from Pondicherry.
Like Abhay Talvi, happy birthday.
I think he is.
Thank you. Let's start.
Oh, yes. I couldn't see you, Dr. Prakash here.
Not the display, Abhidhavi.
Veersha, please start, Dr. Veersha.
Yes, sir. Okay, so I'm presenting a case of a 50-year-old male patient, Kashiram, farmer by occupation, presented to the hospital 5 days ago with the chief complaints of abdominal pain for 2 months, vomiting for 2 months, and lump in the abdomen for 1.5 months. Patient was relatively asymptomatic 2 months ago, after which he developed pain in the abdomen, which was present in the upper abdomen, dull aching in nature, moderate, intermittent, aggravated on taking meals, relieved by vomiting. It was not radiating and not referred to any other site. He also complains of non-bilious vomiting, foul smelling. He used to vomit every third or fourth day. Every third or fourth day, then every alternate day, which even contained food particles taken a day before occasionally, and for 15 days, he has vomiting every day. The vomiting occurs usually in the postprandial period, is projectile in nature, preceded by nausea. The vomiting contains undigested food particles. It also gives history of vomiting altered color, that is coffee ground vomit, for 2 to 3 times in the past 15 days. He also complains of lump in the abdomen for past 1.5 months. Initially, the patient has distension of abdomen, which became more prominent after meals, after which he consulted a local doctor who told him that he had lump in the upper part of his abdomen. The lump has increased in size over 1.5 months, which was initially of smaller size around 5 centimeters and has gradually increased to present size of around 15 centimeters. It has increased gradually with no sudden increase in size of the lump. He also complains of constipation for 15 to 20 days that passes stool once in 3 to 4 days, anorexia, decreased appetite, black colored stools for 4 to 5 times in the past 15 days, loss of weight 10 to 12 kilos in 2 months. He has no history of acute excruciating pain in the abdomen, colic abdominal pain, discoloration of urine sclera, fever, diarrhea, syncope, giddiness, excruciating lower limb pain, flushing, breathlessness, back pain. He has been given 2 blood transfusions after his admission. He has no history of TB, diabetes, hypertension, surgery in the past, hospitalization, blood transfusion, or jaundice in the past. He is a tobacco chewer for 30 to 35 years, consumes it daily, 2 to 3 packets. He has no history of drinking alcohol. He has normal smoking. He has normal vegetarian diet. His bowel is constipated. Bladder habits are normal. Sleep is normal and appetite is decreased. He has no significant family history. Drug and allergic history is not significant. I've examined my patient in adequate light and exposure with proper consent of the patient. Patient is well oriented to time, place and person. Is conscious and cooperative. Fairly built, poorly nourished. 18.7 is the BMI. 60% is the Karnofsky performance scale. He has no pallor, icterus, sinusitis, clubbing. Edema is present over both lower limbs, which is pitting in nature. Inguinal lymph nodes are palpable bilaterally, form non-tender, sub-centimeter size, no other lymphadenopathy. Pulse is 84, blood pressure is 102/70, back and spinal normal. Local examination inspection. A single approximately 15/10 cm vertically oval ill-defined lump is seen occupying the epigastrium umbilicus right hypochondriac region, extending approximately 5 cm below the ziphoid sternum in midline and 15 cm from below there, reaching up to the right costal margin in mid-clavicular line that moves with respiration, is pulsatile with no visible peristalsis or impulse on cuffing. The skin over the lump is normal with no scar, sinus or dilated veins. This is a representation of the same.
Can I come in?
On performing the Carnot's test, the lump becomes less prominent and decreases in size. Umbilicus is transversely stretched, central and inverted. Abdomen appears distended. Bilateral flank fullness is present. Respiration is abdominothoracic in nature. There is no renal angle fullness. External genital and urinal sites are normal. Patient is catheterized. The religious thread is present around the patient's lower abdomen. So this shows the lump. A closer picture. This is a video with the transmitted pulsations and moving with respiration. On palpation, a single normal temperature non-tender, 24 transversely, 14 longitudinally centimeter oval, well-defined lump is felt occupying the epigastrium right and left hypochondrial umbilical region, extending 5 centimeters below the symphysis sternum in midline, reaching up to the right costal margin, 4 centimeters from the left costal margin, 10 centimeters from the anterior axillary line on the right side, and 12 centimeters from the anterior axillary line on the left side. The lump has nodular surface variable consistency with 10 by 12 centimeter stony hard lump palpable in the epigastrium and right hypochondriac region, and rest of the lump is hard with firm consistency in between. The lump moves with respiration, is pulsatile, no cuff impulse, not compressible, no visible peristalsis, and no thrill is palpable. It is not freely mobile and not fixed to overlying skin. Fingers can be insinuated between the lump and the costal margin on both sides. Succussion splash is heard. Liver and spleen are not palpable. Is the longitudinal percussion liver dullness starts in the fifth intercostal space, is present up to the right costal margin in mid-clavicular line, continues with the lump in mid-clavicular line. Liver span is 11 centimeters. The there is dull node present all over the lump. Shifting dullness is present. Horseshoe dullness cannot be elicited due to the lump. Succussion splash is heard. Normal bowel sounds are heard. No abnormal sounds or bruise is heard. Perirectal examination is within normal limits. Left supraclavicular lymphoid is not palpable. RS CVS are within normal. My 50-year-old male patient Kashiram complaining of upper abdominal pain, which is aggravated on meal, relieved on vomiting. The vomiting which occurs 5 to 10 minutes after meals, which is coffee ground for 2 to 3 times. He has also complained of lump in the upper abdomen, which is gradually increased in size. Patient has history of constipation, anorexia, decreased appetite, melanin, loss of weight. He has been given 2 blood products after admission. He is a tobacco chewer for 30 to 35 years. On examination, he has spitting edema over both lower limbs, a single normal temperature, non-tender, 24 transversely, 14 longitudinally centimeter oval, well-defined lump is felt occupying the epigastrium, right and left hypochondriac and umbilical region. The nodular surface variable, hard to stony hard consistency that moves with respiration, with transmitted pulsation, is not freely mobile and not fixed to overlying skin. Fingers can be insinuated between the lump and both side costal margin. Succussion splash is present. Dull node is present over the lump. Shifting dullness is present. A provisional diagnosis would be a gastric outlet obstruction due to a mass arising from the stomach. Thank
you. I request Faculty to take over, sir. Abhay, sir, please.
Can you go back to the history?
Yes, sir.
What is constipated bowel?
Sir, usually any bowel movement up to 3 times a day or once in 3 days would be considered normal, and above that
constipated bowel.
Sorry, sir,
you have written bowel constipated. What do you mean by bowel constipation?
No, sir, I have written constipation for 15 to 20 days.
You said so patient is constipated, not bowel. This is what's
Yes. Only trying to point out, you cannot say bowel is constipated. Patient is constipated, I can understand.
Yes, sir.
My second question to you is, you said this patient has flank fullness. What does flank fullness indicate to you?
Sorry, sir?
What does flank fullness mean to you?
Sir, the flank fullness would be a earlier sign of ascites, as the fluid will first accumulate in the flanks.
So, did you percuss to see?
Yes, sir. I have percussed. Shifting dullness is present, sir. Horseshoe dullness could not be elicited because a lump was occupying majority of the upper abdomen.
Okay. At the end of the history, before examination of the patient, what would be your provisional diagnosis?
At the end of the history, sir, it seemed to be due to gastric outlet obstruction due to the typical symptoms that he had. But the cause could not be confirmed. Most likely due to the stomach.
And at the end of your examination, what is your diagnosis?
Sir, at the end of the examination, it seems pretty clear that it is a gastric outlet obstruction arising from a mass from the stomach, due to mass from the stomach.
Mass from the stomach is not a diagnosis.
Yes, sir. So most probably it can be either due to carcinoma, as its incidence is high, or there can be certain other pathologies like a gastrointestinal stromal tumor or a GI lymphoma.
Third one?
lymphoma of the stomach, sir.
Lymphoma of the stomach. Okay. Some other examiner can come in.
Sorry, sir?
No, no. Some other examiner, okay, if you want to ask questions, can come in.
Yes.
Andarya Saab.
Yes, sir.
Please take over, sir.
Okay. So, what are the points which leads you to diagnosis of gastric outlet obstruction? What is the typical history and examination finding of gastric outlet obstruction, irrespective of this finding or this case?
Yes, sir. The patient will usually have vomiting, which will occur postprandially and will contain food particles even from the day before. And it will be non-bilious in nature and will contain some amount of undigested food particles. There will be a suckation splash will be heard.
Stop. Sir? You said postprandial vomiting. So is it always postprandial?
No, sir. In this case, it is
postprandial. When you say postprandial, it has to be the food particle which he has ingested during that meal. So yes, probably it may not be postprandial. It may get accumulated, and when it is about to overflow, it may, or it is stretching, it may, patient may vomit. Okay, first. Then?
Then a succussion splash.
How do you explain succussion splash? In what examinations you can elicit succussion splash?
Sir, usually it is better confirmed on auscultation, but if the stomach is distended hugely, it can even be felt on palpation.
How do you elicit in palpation?
Sir, there are two methods which have been described. One is that the lump can be fixed by two hands with a hand, and then it can be tapped.
For outlet obstruction, you don't need to fix the lump. To elicit succussion splash, you don't need to fix the lump.
Yes, sir. So we can tap over the lump with our hand, which can lead to movement of fluid inside the stomach, which will be partially filled with fluid and partially empty.
It is a semi elicitation of dangling movement. Just you do it in ascites. You do like this, tapping. Okay, that is one.
And second is, in some books it has been described that the entire patient can also be moved from the waist.
You don't do. You don't advocate.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So where will you put your one hand, and where will you put your second hand to elicit this sign?
One hand will be placed over the lump in the epigastrium, and second hand.
No, you are not right. So lump is a firm or hard structure, right?
Yes.
So when you put one hand on the hard or firm structure, you are probably, see, succussion's place is a sign to be elicited for huge amount of fluid, which is not covering the entire hollow organ. And there is a space inside the organ which the fluid is getting shifted, and you are able to move the bubbling sound of succussion or movement of fluid. So you have to put your hand on the part which is filled with fluid. So you have to put it medial and superior to the lump, palpable if it is gastric mass. Do you get it?
Yes, sir.
If you don't put it on mass. That is very clear.
Yes, sir.
Did you elicit gastric movement in this patient on palpation?
Peristalsis?
Yes.
Sir, it was not possible, as the patient was not able to tolerate any diet, sir, and the patient.
Yes, established obstruction. This is a mass. It's a different issue. Suppose there is a patient with benign peptic ulcer and gastric outlet obstruction. Right? In that case, what the signs will be present will be, one will be succussion splash. That too, when patient is vomited, you may not get the sign. Second thing is peristalsis of the stomach, which you can see in the larger area. The J-shaped stomach is many a times hanging up to the pelvis. So how do you elicit this stomach peristalsis?
We'll ask the patient to take some amount of fluid. No,
you have to elicit one palpation.
Yes, sir. We can move our fingers, the tips of our fingers, over the abdomen from left side to right side, like stroking the stomach.
Right to left.
Stroking the stomach.
Usually, excuse me, sir, I am Dr. Anandi. Okay. Regarding visible gastric peristalsis,
why
usually
do you think it is malignancy, not benign mass?
Inspection finding. We don't do it under palpation. What is your opinion on this, sir?
External compression of stomach from a benign disease from outside. What are your points? I don't say you are wrong, but what are the points to justify that this is a malignant mass arising from stomach?
Sir, the growth of the mass that has occurred over a relatively short period from 5 cm to 15 cm over 1.5 months. Then the sir patient has a history of weight loss, anorexia, and decreased appetite, which can also be present in a patient with gastric outer obstruction, but which also go clear of this. And the patient has ascites, sir. Which can be due to
two more symptoms you missed.
Sorry, sir.
Two more findings you missed. History.
Yes, sir.
Bleeding.
Yes, sir. The patient has bleeding. Coffee ground vomitus is present.
Hematemesis?
Sir, the patient
you
has.
You asked the hematemesis.
Yes, sir. The patient has history of coffee ground vomitus for 2 to 3 times in the past 15 days.
You asked in history?
Yes, sir.
Yes, he mentioned.
Oh, actually, when will you get Melina?
Yes, sir.
When will you get Melina?
Sir, when the bleeding is arising usually from an upper GI cause that passes through the bowel and comes out through the lower GI part. Due to the changes in the hemoglobin, so the stool will be black tarry, melena.
Yeah, right.
So actually, did you mention anything about asphaltopercussion?
Sorry, sir?
Asphaltopercussion. Did you mention anything about asphaltopercussion?
Auscultation, sir.
Auscultopercussion.
Yes, sir, I have mentioned about percussion.
No, not percussion, auscultopercussion. Because you told...
How will you do auscultopercussion?
Auscultopercussion, auscultopercussion. Yes, sir, I did that during succussion splash.
How will you do that?
Sir, we will keep our stethoscope over the part that is distended. And then we will percuss over the abdomen. We will That will lead to... a sound similar to succussion slash.
No. Question is not that. Question is, you told stomach is distended. How will you measure that stomach is distended in clinical? That is called auscultopercussion, no?
Yes, sir.
See, when you want to do an auscultopercussion, you have to use the bell of the stethoscope, keep it over the epigastric region and try to make a gentle strokes in the radial axis along the bell of the stethoscope so that you can measure the points where you can mark the points and you try to join all the points, which will give you the idea about how far your greater curvature of the stomach is going to be present, whether it is coming down below the level of your umbilicus, indicating it is a distended stomach.
In one point I'll mention, sorry to interrupt you, faculties, when you don't know the answer, always say that, sorry sir or madam, I do not know, rather than pulling on. This is ultimately a correct answer. Carry on, madam.
And regarding succussion splash, when we are telling, sir, usually succussion splash is the finding which we elicit when the patient is in a lying down posture. We ask the person to take the, either it can be done usually by auscultatory method, they do it. They keep the bell of the stethoscope again at the epigastric region using the left hand, and using the right hand, they gently stroke the abdominal wall and they try to elicit the succussion splash. That is the method usually just being taught for the students. But regarding this palpatory maneuver, in case of an over-distended stomach, when you have a partially filled stomach, in that case also you'll be able to hear the succussion splash by just gently shaking.
Dr. Veer?
Yes, sir.
What are the different causes of gastric outer obstruction apart from stomach?
Sir, pancreatitis, which can involve the second part of duodenum, can lead to inflammation of the part of duodenum. Yes, sir.
How pancreatitis leads to obstruction?
The entire thing is known as group pancreatitis.
Now you are digging your grave. Huh?
That is very rare. Do you want to say that?
Now we are going into group pancreatitis. Do you know something about group pancreatitis, my dear?
Sir, the inflammation that occurs due to pancreatitis secondarily involves the groove, that is the second part of duodenum, can lead to.
What is this groove?
Sir, it is the area in which the ampulla will open in the second part of the duodenum.
No, what is groove?
I don't know.
Thank you. So tell the common causes first. Apart from causes in the stomach, what are the other causes of gastric outlet obstruction?
Sir, a mass arising from the transverse colon, sir, can infiltrate into the stomach.
Tell common causes.
Apart from malignancy.
How many cases of pseudocyst of the pancreas have you seen while working in the ward?
A lot many, sir.
None of them had vomiting?
They had, sir. They had.
Then why you are not coming to common causes, my dear?
Sorry.
Why you are scratching the examiner into group pancreatitis and all their causes which...
If you know the other name of group pancreatitis, it will be easier to remember. But forget that. That is paraduodenal.
Pseudocyst
arising from head.
Yes, sir. Pseudocyst arising from the head.
But benign causes is commoner. I gave you one hint in the questionnaire. Though it is not common nowadays, it was common at least 2 decades ago.
Tell me, where is duodenal?
Ulcer arising in the duodenum, sir. Duodenal ulcer.
Duodenal ulcer with obstruction, right?
Yes, sir.
That is not part of the stomach.
Yes, sir.
Correct or no?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Anything else?
Sir,
okay, how do you elicit a visible gastric peristalsis?
Ma'am, we can stroke the abdomen with our fingers.
Inspection.
On inspections, we will ask the patient to take some amount of fluid. And we will wait for around, we will be at the level of the abdomen and we'll wait for around 10 minutes.
What do you mean by being at the level of the abdomen?
Means our vision.
Yeah, you have to say you have to be in a tangential view at the level of the abdominal wall, right? Either along the sides or along the foot end. You go to the foot end and be at the level of the toes so that you can see the vision where the wave is going to go. What is the direction of the wave in the case of a gastric peristalsis and what is the direction in case of an intestinal peristalsis?
In gastric peristalsis, it will be from left to right, upper to lower. And in intestinal peristalsis, it will be the opposite.
What is the reason why you want to give water to the... Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Why do you want to give water to the stomach to induce peristalsis?
Jagan free air kana kila rajal in the class attend pantrathu.
Sir,
PG class.
I'm not sure, sir.
What does water do?
It induces lead to the activation of the stomach pacemakers that.
It induces peristalsis because something goes into the stomach.
Yes.
Okay. Let's go ahead. Let's take it as your diagnosis of malignant lesion of the stomach giving rise to gastric outlet obstruction.
Yes.
How do you go about? And this patient obviously has ascites too.
Yes.
Go about treating this patient.
What is
it? Go about treating this patient or investigating whatever.
How will you manage?
Yes, sir. on further investigation, sir, there are investigations by which I will confirm my diagnosis, and there are certain blood investigations. First, I will do the investigations which will confirm my diagnosis, which will start with an ultrasound of the abdomen.
Why?
Sir, it will help me know the organ of the origin, which is there, though it is not very good for assessment of stomach pathologies. Later on, ultrasound is usually cheap and easily available.
One minute, wait.
Yes, sir.
You are choosing ultrasound as a primary investigation. In the same breath, you are telling me it is not a very good investigation.
Sir, just to know the organ of origin so that we can move to...
Don't contradict yourself.
Yes.
If you are saying sonography, you say sonography and give reasons for sonography, what you are going to get out of it. Don't tell me that it is a useless investigation, but still I'm going to do it. That's not going to go well with the examiner.
Yes.
Particularly when you say to confirm the diagnosis.
It's like telling the girl, you are very good, but I don't like you. It won't help. Okay, go ahead.
Then I will proceed with a contrast and then CT scan of the abdomen.
Wait. I would like you to answer in a way when you are sending a patient for a particular investigation or asking for a particular investigation. I want you to tell me what you are going to get out of it. So, sonography you have done on this patient and you have got your examination findings. What are you going to tell the sonologist? These are the things we have examined, and I want from you many more things also apart from my findings. List out everything that you are going to ask from the sonologist. What do you expect?
Yes, sir. I'll ask about the organ of the origin, then the extent of the mass, whether there are any lymph nodes which can be seen, then about the ascites which is present, the amount of the ascites which is present, whether there is any secondary involvement or any metastasis to any other organs, particularly the liver, is all I will ask. Then the characteristics of the mass, whether it is hypoechoic or it is hyperechoic.
What is the next thing?
Next investigation would be, sir, a contrast enhanced CT scan with of the abdomen.
So before that, can you plan for any other thing?
Yes, sir. We will plan for an upper GI scopy and esophagogastroduodenoscopy.
What are you likely to find in this patient on endoscopy?
Carcinoma, which is rising, we will be able to see the entire mass. It might have infiltrated the entire wall of the part of the stomach. If in case it is a gastrointestinal stromal tumor, GIST or something, we might not be able to see the mass.
Again, you are going into gastrointestinal stromal tumors, which tells me that you have read about stromal tumors that come, and I'm not going to ask you a single question. You're smiling, I can see that. So when you do an endoscopy, what are the things that you are going to see?
Sir, the mass that is there, then the whether it is causing any gastric outlet obstruction, whether we can go beyond the pylorus or not, whether there are any clots or there are any bleeding spots which are present.
See, when you are going to do an endoscopy, you will not be able to see a mass. You are going to see an ulcer. Okay, you don't see a mass.
That's what I'm trying to ask him, Anandi. I'm trying to ask him the same
thing.
Visualize the tip of the endoscope going in and tell me all that you are likely to see. Have you ever seen an endoscopy being done?
Yes.
Okay, if you have seen, tell me as the scope goes into the stomach, your bypass gone through the GE junction, what is the first thing that you are going to see in this patient if the patient is not well prepared?
A lot of undigested food which will be present.
That is the first thing. Now let's take that the patient is well prepared and the endoscope is going in. What is the first thing that you are going to see?
Sir, ulceration of the wall.
Where do you expect?
Usually in the body and antrum, sir.
You have reached the body, but you are still, you are just across the GE junction. What is the first thing you are likely to see?
A huge dilated stomach.
You are likely to see the normal mucosa. What will be the condition of normal mucosa in this patient? Will it not be inflamed?
Yes, sir.
Because of chronic stasis, will it not be inflamed? Red?
Yes, sir.
You may find small erosions because you have given me history of coffee ground vomiter.
Yes, sir.
That will be there. Then as you go forward, you will come in contact with the so-called mass. As Anand has correctly said, you will find a growth or an ulcer which is large because you are palpating a big tumor. So when you are answering any finding as far as investigation is concerned, especially endoscopy, if you have seen endoscopic procedure, you should describe as if your eye is going into the stomach and visualizing things. Last thing will come that the endoscopy is unable to get into the pylorus and the pylorus is the duodenum. So can you summarize now, thinking that you are doing endoscopy, what are the different things that you will see?
As soon as if I enter the gastrointestinal junction, esophageal junction, if the stomach is not well prepared, patient is not well prepared, then there will be undigested food particles. If the patient is prepared, on entering, I might find the mucosa, which is a bit inflamed due to the chronic stasis. Later, I might find an ulcer or a growth, which is there. And finally, I will see whether the pylorus can be negotiated or not.
Very nice. Now, what is the next thing that you will do with the endoscopy?
Sir, I will take a biopsy.
Where will you take the biopsy from?
I will take biopsy from all six, at least from six places, different areas where the growth is there.
How will you measure the ulcer? How do you know the size of the ulcer?
I don't know that. On endoscopy,
On endoscopy only.
No,
because when you're going to see an endoscopy, we'll say it's a large ulcer or a small ulcer, like that we'll be saying, no? How do you say the measurements?
I don't know.
See, when you open up the biopsy forceps, which you are going to take for endoscopy, each prong is going to be around 2 millimeter. So when you're going to open it up like this, it's going to be around 4 millimeter. So when you're going to keep it like this, we can be able to see the rough size of the ulcer. Whether it's going to be around 1 centimeter or it's going to be 2 centimeter, like that, you'll be able to judge and say the size of the ulcer. Okay.
Have you seen biopsy being taken?
Sorry, sir?
Have you seen a biopsy being taken from a stomach ulcer?
I have seen an H. pylori issue being taken. I have not seen a biopsy.
You have seen biopsy. How is it sent to pathology?
It is sent
in saline or formalin?
Formalin, sir.
Sure. Dr. Ganesh Babu is smiling. I am asking basic questions.
Yes, sir.
I want to know whether the boys worked in the wards or no.
Yes.
Because I know he will tell me all classifications of GIST, etc., etc.
Yes,
I just want to know whether he has worked in the ward. Fine, you have done endoscopy, you have taken biopsy. You have sent it for pathology examination. What next?
Sorry, sir?
What next?
Sir, based on the investigations, I will continue by doing a CT scan. And I will also do some blood investigations, which will tell me about the general condition of the patient, the hemoglobin.
Hemoglobin is six.
Yes, sir. So I'll consider a blood transfusion for the patient.
What else? You said patient has pleural edema.
Yes, sir. So I'll do a serum albumin level to see whether his nutritional built, which is there.
Albumin is 2. So hemoglobin 6, albumin 2.
So that shows that the patient is very malnourished and needs to be prepared by giving proper nutrition.
Okay. How will CT scan influence our
treatment
in this patient? How will a CT scan influence your
patient? A CT scan will give us certain clues about whether the disease is localized or it has spread to other parts, which can help us know whether if it is a mass, it is resectable or not. it will show us certain lymph nodes. It will give us the amount of ascites which is there. And it will give us exact measurements about the mass. And we can check for metastasis at locations. And of course, it will confirm the organ of origin if it is arising from any other part or the pathology is something different.
Now again, see this answer, the examiner is not in good mood, is going to catch you. You are
see, now what position in which you want to take a CT scan.
Sorry, Anandi, go ahead.
Sorry, ma'am. Sorry, sir. Go ahead. The question which I wanted to ask was, you want to do a CECT of the abdomen, no?
Yes.
You wanted to say, you wanted to assess about the infiltration to the adjacent structures and the deeper structures. In what position would you like to take the CECT of the abdomen?
The sound was there.
CECT abdomen is when you want to know about the posterior infiltration to the pancreas, they tend to do it in a prone position so that the organ, concerned organ, the stomach will fall away from the pancreas if it's not going to be stuck to it. So they do it in a prone position. So you can go ahead, sir.
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Now tell me, this patient has a large mass. Let us assume that there is no ascites.
Yes.
And there are no nodes. Liver is normal. It is free from pancreas.
Yes.
Treat this patient.
So first, I will prepare the patient. I will correct the malnutrition. I will correct the anemia. I will correct the hydration status of the patient.
How?
Veer. This is an important thing. You should not say I will correct. You have to say what you have to do.
Correct.
That's what exam they expect. Otherwise, you will get into trouble.
Yes. To correct the anemia, sir, I'll give blood transfusion. To correct the nutrition status, sir, if the pylorus can be flushed, a nasojejunal tube can be placed with the nutrition can be given. we can provide the patient with albumin infusions if the patient is affording.
There should not be a word if the patient is affording.
I know.
Yeah, so we'll give the patient albumin infusion, which will lead to correction of his nutrition along with hydrating him for 5 to 6 days with normal saline and ring electrolyte. And he will also have some serum electrolyte deficiency. That has to be corrected.
What is the difference between acute dehydration and chronic dehydration?
Sir, here there will be, I'm not sure about the question.
According to you, this is acute dehydration or chronic dehydration?
Chronic dehydration, sir. Chronic dehydration.
How do you correct chronic dehydration?
Sir, we will give normal saline, sir.
No, that is the fluid that you want to give. You think you can give him 4 liters in a day and correct his hydration?
No, sir. Around 1.5 to 2 liters a day.
Is it rapid correction of dehydration or slow correction of dehydration?
Relatively slow correction, sir.
Why the word relatively?
Slow correction. Compared to if it would have been an acute thing, we corrected relatively slow.
How much blood this patient will require according to you to correct his hemoglobin to 10?
Sir, around 4 pints. Sir.
Why do you say 4 pints?
So usually 1.5 is the amount that will be corrected by one transfusion of PC.
Okay, good. Go ahead. So you have corrected over a period of 5 to 6 days his nutrition. His C-ready is gone. His hemoglobin has come up to 11. PCV is normal. There are no reticulocytes except a high reticulocyte. And the patient is ready for surgery. How will you now, tomorrow is the operation. Today, what will be your orders?
Today, we might consider placing a central line for
there
monitoring.
Is no might in patient.
We'll place a central line. We'll place a central line. We'll place a central line to the patient. We'll keep the patient NDM. Next day, first we'll plan, sir, for a diagnostic laparoscopy.
Still, your preparation is not over. How will you plan?
Sir, the surgery?
So you are planning a surgery. What orders will you advise before taking him to preoperative room?
Yes, sir. He has to be kept nil by now.
Is that enough?
No, sir.
Have you written preoperative orders yourself?
Yes, sir.
What are the orders that you write?
Sir, we'll keep the patient nil by mouth. We'll give the patient antibiotic on the day of the on the 1 hour before the incision. We will do shaving of the patient from nipple to knee region, and we will take proper consent of the patient regarding what will be our plan of management regarding the surgery that we can undertake. It might also be aborting the surgery if metastasis is occult metastasis is found on performing the surgery.
What metastasis?
Occult, which occult we could not detect.
What is occult metastasis?
Basically, I mean that if we could not detect that from the imaging modalities that we had missed. Like that.
So if you put in a diagnostic laparoscope in this patient, you find a large node there, it is occult, it has been missed by the CT in reporting.
Anyway, no sir, usually the
word occult when you are doing some surgery.
Sir, that was small or that could not have been
operative orders.
Sorry.
You cannot tell me preoperative orders which are written in the patient scheduled for surgery tomorrow.
Doesn't yes, sir. Keep the patient nil by mouth. Give the dose of antibiotic day before surgery. 1 hour before surgery.
Where are you from?
Ahmedabad, sir.
Are you writing orders like that? I'm sorry, I'm talking in Hindi. What is the first thing that you write?
Patient is...
surgery tomorrow.
Yes, sir.
What is the second line that you write?
The surgery that is being planned for the patient is diagnostic laparoscopy followed by distal or total gastrectomy for an indication of carcinoma stomach.
बाद में next line में क्या लिखते हैं?
Do shaving of the patient from nipple to knee region.
Then
take proper informed and written consent of the patient.
What is proper?
Where he has been explained about the complications and about the plan that is exactly...
Informed consent. What is informed proper?
No, no, sir. Informed consent.
Is there anything improper?
No, no, sir.
Then why use word?
Informed consent of the patient. Then pre-anesthetic checkup of the patient.
Correct.
Then overnight... of pint that is given to the patient.
IV fluids, I understand.
Now
you are a final year student, right?
Yes, sir.
So you must be having two juniors.
Yes.
So you will tell them, do this also. I want it tomorrow before boss comes.
Send a blood group cross match of the patient.
Thank you very much.
And one more investigation. 6 a.m. morning.
ABGA may be considered.
No, before that?
No.
Before that?
As the electrolytes are altered, the serum electrolytes will be
changed. Don't say electrolytes altered, say serum electrolyte. That is the answer.
Serum electrolyte.
Don't chew the gum and pull it longer.
Yes.
No, your patient will be on rails tube or you'll put rails tube on the table?
Rails tube. Riles tube.
When will you decide? Whether it is on the day or previous day itself?
Okay, Mr. Previous day, we will put a riles tube and we'll give a wash to the stomach so that all the undigested particles and the organisms that have grown can be cleared.
That point is also very important. Even in pre-op order also, you should document that.
Yes.
What about pre-op 3-4 days, 5 days physiotherapy?
Yes, sir. Chest physiotherapy will be started for the patient as it is a major surgery.
No justification required. What? Okay. Yes. The question which is asked, answer that only. Answers which are not questions do not carry any credit mark. They do carry discredit sometimes. Listen to the question for a fraction of a second and then answer. Monitor his pre-operative, day before surgery urine output.
Sorry, sir.
Will you monitor his pre-operative day, pre-surgery day urine output?
Not necessarily in every patient.
Oh.
Hey, what is wrong in saying yes?
You may not be observing, but it has to be, yes.
Yes.
Now you are antagonizing examiner from Gujarat only. Ahmedabad wala. Anyway, you have taken patient on table, patient is anesthetized. And you said you will do a diagnostic laparoscopy. What do you mean by doing a diagnostic laparoscopy on this patient? And what will you have some...
Sir, some peritoneal meds are not easily detected on a CT scan, and some small liver meds may be missed on CT scan.
This is not the way to answer. When you do a diagnostic laparoscopy,
when we put the scope inside,
way of doing diagnostic laparoscopy.
When we put the scope inside, we will find some amount of ascitic fluid. We will take that fluid for cytology and we will send it for cytology. And we will look inside the entire abdomen. We will look whether there are any peritoneal involvement, there are any meds in the peritoneum. Okay. And we will also look for if there are any small meds which have been missed on CT scan in the liver. And we will also look for the nodes properly, which are visible.
Nodes will tell you, if you see them large, that is likely to be inoperable. I'm not saying non-resectable, I'm saying inoperable.
Sir, the para-aortic and aortocaval nodes.
How easily do you see para-aortic or aortocaval nodes?
It requires a lot of dissection.
It requires dissection, right?
Lumbar shelf, if it is
seen. Somebody like Palanivelu will finish D2 gastrectomy while trying to look for aortocaval nodes.
Diagnostic laparoscopy itself.
there are drop metastasis in the pouch of Douglas.
What metastasis?
Drop metastasis in the pouch of Douglas.
What is this drop metastasis?
Sir, so it is described like that in books that the meds through the through the peritoneal path, they might settle in the pouch of Douglas. So known as drop metastasis.
If it was a female, then there is some drop metastasis in the ovaries. What is it known as?
Krukenberg tumor.
Why does it reach ovarially?
Ovary are true intraperitoneal organs as they have a connection with the intra-abdominal part.
What do you mean by true intra-abdominal and a false intra-abdominal organ?
Sir, usually intraperitoneal organs are one which are covered on two sides, on all sides by the peritoneum, but they have no communication with the peritoneal cavity. The ovaries, they have a communication with the peritoneal cavity.
They are divided off visceral peritoneum. Amir, carry on.
Okay, your tumor now is operable on a diagnostic laparoscopy. You are opening the abdomen. What are you going to do? What are the steps you are going to follow now?
If the tumor is operable.
Yeah.
Then.
What do you mean by operable? What do you mean by resectable?
Operable is when there is no spread to organs which would make it a metastatic tumor. So we can operate and clear off the entire tumor. That is operable. And resectable is when it is adherent to certain vessels, particularly the arteries, which cannot be resected and reconstructed.
Okay. No, no. So now what are you going to do?
You just explain what is resectability again.
Sir, the arteries like the celiac artery, the SMA, if they are encased for more than 180 degrees, then they cannot be resected and reconstructed. So such tumors we will consider unresectable. And certain major veins like the IVC, aorta, or portal vein, if they are completely involved, then the tumor may whenever a vessel which is
let's be very clear. When you say operable, the intent is to cure. When you say resectable, the intention is not to cure but partially palliate. That means you know you are leaving some tumor tissue behind. So let's be very clear about it. Don't here and there involvement of aorta, encasement of vessel, etc., etc. That is not. Operability means intent to cure. Resection means knowingly that some amount of microscopic malignancy may remain behind at the end of resection. This is the definition.
So, Veer, you are able to understand. You should be very clear. You no need to say about vessels. Resectability doesn't include vessels alone. It's very clear. Operable means intent is cure.
See, you are talking about resectability. That is for the pancreatic lesion, which you are talking about your vessel encasement and other things. Here, we are talking about the general thing in the case of a CA stomach regarding operability and a resectability. By resectability here, we can resect even a tumor which is going to be adherent to that of the pancreas. We'll be able to remove it, but what happens is we'll be leaving behind some of the microscopic tissues attached to that of the pancreas. Okay. Whereas when you say it is operable, we mean to that we are able to give a complete cure. There is no evidence of any residual disease. It's almost an R0. Okay. So that is operable. There should not be any metastasis should be present, like ascites or peritoneal deposits or omental, anything should not be there. Everything has to be cleared away. Then it becomes a operable tumor and it is a, we are going to give a curative intent. So that is operable.
So considering that the tumor is operable, what is the operation that you plan?
Here, look, as the tumor is very large, we will either go for a near total or a total gastrectomy.
In a radical gastrectomy, what are the organs other than stomach that you remove?
We might have to remove the spleen, the pancreas.
pancreas?
Tail of the pancreas. Tail of the pancreas.
Greater omentum,
then the pancreatic capsule, the lymph nodes.
Now, what are the various lymph nodes? Nowadays, they call them stations, no?
Yes, lymph nodes.
Different stations?
Sir, in the D1, there are 6 stations. The station 1 will be right to the cardia, station 2 will be left to the cardia. Station 3 will be nodes along the lesser curvature. Station 4 will be 4A, 4B along the greater curvature. Station 5 will be suprapyloric. Station 6 will be infrapyloric. And from the 7 to 11, station 7 will be celiac. Station 8 will be common hepatic. Station 9
7
will
is
be,
not celiac.
Station 7 will be left gastric. Station 8 will be celiac. Station 9 will be common hepatic.
Again, station 8 is not celiac. Station 9 only is celiac.
Station 8 will be common hepatic. Station 9 will be celiac. Station 10 will be splenic hilum. And station 11 will be splenic artery.
The advantage of sitting in a Zoom meeting in a proper examination nowadays is that the mobile is always in hand. And let me read out drop. What is drop metastasis? Drop metastasis, also known as intramedullary spinal cord metastasis, is a rare complication of cancer affecting blah blah blah. Before MRI being available, most cases of drop metastasis were diagnosed only on autopsy. Now, there is no mention whatsoever of your drop metastasis into the pelvis. Anagwell is now started smiling. So be very careful when you talk of drop metastasis. It is known as transcelomic spread. I can understand. But yes. Drop metastasis is something different, huh?
Yes.
Okay. Now, this is not for you. This is for all others who are who may take home the message that we can call this word drop metastasis in the exam and get away. So be very careful. Veer is from Ahmedabad. Wo Gujarat kaise phatak se bolte hai confidence se aur examiner bhi bhul jayega. So all students be very careful.
Yes. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So let's come back to your patient. He has ascites and you have taken ascitic fluid. It comes positive for metastasis. Now, how do you go about treating this patient?
Sir, then still as there is gastric outer obstruction, we need to establish some nutrition pathway for the patient. So we might do a feeding jejunostomy for the patient so that he can be given nutrition.
Dr. Veer, please understand the question. By just having an operable tumor, a bit of ascites which is positive, do you see the line of your surgical extent of resection going to change or not? The question is very straight on your face. We don't want to consider feeding gynecostomy. Those things are much later. At this point, will your policy of surgery change? If it is going to change, on what basis you will change the policy of the extent of resection? That is the question. Please answer to the question.
Yes. Yes. Sir, if the patient is fit for surgery, as there is also bleeding from the tumor, we might consider a palliative resection. If he is not fit for surgery, to tolerate a long procedure, we will do a gastrojejunostomy to bypass the obstruction which is present.
Dr. Veersha, you have still not got into the crux of the question. The current NCCN guideline says you are TNM staging and TY staging. TY is the cytology staging. Is not directly influential. If you have a cytic fluid positivity with macroscopic peritoneal deposits, then your surgery have to be a restricted surgery or, as you say, for tiding over the complications. If you do not have macroscopic peritoneal metastasis, ascites CY plus, your policy do not change in the extent of resection. That is the answer for respective tell. Then comes the question of how much of stomach or what other things. So if the examiner expects a specific answer from you, please grab the, see, examiner wants to get an answer from you. Please assimilate the question before going to the next step. Now telling if it is peritoneal macroscopically negative, CY positive, what will be your plan in this patient?
Sir, as you said that, then our plan of management will be same as it was before. We will try to do an operable resection. Operative resection.
Okay, what is the extent of gastric resection you will talk? Then we'll go to the other. What is the, what are you going for T?
Sorry, sir?
What is the extent of resection for the T status of the tumor?
Yes, sir. Sir, it should be at least 5 centimeters proximal margin has to be achieved.
And distal?
Sir, distal margin is also preferred as 5 centimeters, but at times as the D2 is there, 2 centimeter margin can be done.
Please quantify. You are talking about a gastric outlet obstruction, right? In that case, do you think it is technically feasible for a 5 or 2 centimeter margin at all?
A 2 centimeter margin is feasible.
Okay. If that, if you are not able to give 2 centimeter margin, does it become you are going to abandon the procedure?
No, no, sir. We might consider for smaller margin unless we can do a R0 resection.
That should be the answer. See, if you are able to give a 1 centimeter margin, it is optimal. But if you are going beyond the pyloroduodenal junction, yeah, macroscopic margin negative resection is all what is to be achieved, right? That should be the right message. Now we move on to the circumferential margin. Madam was asking about a specific thing. Assuming you have cleared proximal and distal, your vessels are not encased, you are carefully ligated the feeding vessels. Now, assuming the only main problem of consideration is your posterior adhesions. We are talking about your patient, not about spleen or tail pancreas or here. In this patient, if you have an invasion, which is onto the capsule of the pancreas, what do? If you have an invasion of pancreatic parenchymal infiltration, what do you do?
Sir, if the capsule of pancreas is infiltrated, we can we usually remove the capsule of pancreas also along with the gastric cover. And if there is infiltration of the pancreatic parenchyma, then if it is in the tail, we'll...
We're talking about your patient. Please. Restrict to your patient.
Sir, then, sir... we will have to consider a Whipple's procedure also along with it. The parenchyma is infiltrated.
Whipple's in a patient with positive ascites in a
serious
stomach?
It is infiltrating the parenchyma in the head region.
But will you do a palliative Whipple's for a serious stomach?
I don't know. You have been
the patient home.
The point is very clear. If you cytology is negative, you have focal infiltration into the head of the pancreas. And sir very clearly said your albumin level is 2. The most important risk factor for a postoperative pancreatic fistula is the albumin level. And you are going to involve another 3 more anastomoses if you are proceeding with the Whipple's procedure. Minus what you're going to do, right? So on that basis, the only indication at this point of time for a Whipple's resection is experimental center where they are done on a trial basis, number one. Number two, well-differentiated tumors with favorable nodal status, clinical radiological M0, cytology 0, it can be considered in level 3 and level 4 centers. That's what is the current guideline. At this point of time, as a postgraduate, you are expected to tell, I will do a minimal required procedure, right? Whipple's may be fine. Your center is a designated center for a trial. At this point of time, if there is a head invasion, you have to technically abandon the resection. If capsule involved, failure of pancreas is accepted. All right, that should be the clear answer. Please move on. Can we now talk about what are the incontiguous nodal spread and what are the KIP spread of nodal disease and how do you ascertain the limit of lymphadenectomy?
Sir, I did not get your question.
Okay, fine. We will take it like this. You have cleared the T. You have done an R0 resection. Now we are talking about N clearance. You have nodes in the prepyloric zone. You have nodes in the lesser curve. You have few nodes along the celiac axis. This is where you are talking about. Here, what will be your extent of lymphadenectomy?
D2 lymphadenectomy.
Can you define what is a D2 lymphadenectomy?
Sir, where the stations from station 1 to 11 are removed.
Again, the concepts are changing now. You don't have a broad resection like 1 to 11. Now it has become regional D2. It is not a generalized D2. Generalized D2 resection is no more advocated. Regional D2 is D2 dissection pertinent to the location of the tumor. You don't end up clearing one for a antral tumor. Please understand that. So, your dissection D2 definitions have changed. Now, it is going to be a regional D2 dissection. A very safe way of answering D2 will be, I will do one basin beyond the clinically or surgically positive lymph node, which I find during the operation. That will be the safe approach. Right? At this point of time, all through D2 is not indicated for a regional tumor. That is the current advocation. All right.
Thank you.
So with that in consideration, how you have removed 5 centimeter clearance, you have ligated the celiac vessel, you end up having half the stomach in hand. Do you want to disconnect the distal end? What is the policy followed in your department?
Sorry, sir.
How do you dissect the or resect the distal part of the tumor in this operation? You mean to say you want to do a hands-on closure or you want to do a staple closure? What is the policy and what do you do in your department?
We usually do a hands-on closure of the duodenal stump.
What are the precautions you would like to take in closure of the duodenal stump?
So that the part we are closing should, that duodenum should not be inflamed.
Question of inflammation does not come right. You do not
deal. No, you clearly understood what that are.
You do not devascularize the duodenum, number one. Optimally, depending on your department's policy, a single layer closure or double layer closure is advised. In duodenum, second layer of closure may not be possible, especially if you are going beyond the PD junction for want of R0 resection. In that case, stapled dissection or stapled resection may be little advantageous if you are moving to D1, right? But again, D1 is done in specialized centers. D1 transection is done in specialized centers. At this point of time, you say you will do a layered closure of duodenum. All right, fine. You have removed the stomach, removed the nodes. Now, how do you want to reconstruct this patient after the gastrectomy?
We will do a Roux-en-Y esophageal duodenostomy.
Please understand, have you done a total gastrectomy for this patient?
Either a total or a subtotal gastrectomy.
You have to do one. You cannot do both for the same patient. Na?
Sir,
Have you seen a distal gastrectomy or a near total gastrectomy or a total gastrectomy?
I have seen a distal gastrectomy.
You have seen a distal. Let's talk of distal gastrectomy. Okay. So you have you are saying a Roux-en-Y anastomosis.
Yes.
Right? So stomach anastomosis. Stomach was anastomosis to the jejunum.
Yes, sir. Yes.
What suture material was used?
Sir, Vicryl.
And how many layers?
Sir, 2 layers. First layer we closed with Vicryl, second layer we closed with silk. The seromuscular we took with silk.
Okay. What was it 2-0, 3-0?
So the Vicryl 2-0 and silk also 2-0.
What was the needle size?
Sir, it was, I'm not sure, 1/2, sir.
What?
1/2.
26 mm needle, 30 mm needle, round body needle, cutting needle.
Round body needle, sir.
Utna, that much you know. But you don't know the size of the needle.
No, sir.
I'm asking you this question. Because all of you all don't even bother. Whatever that sister gives you, you take and start suturing. That sister knows what size to give. How big should be the needle? It should go through a thick stomach and a thin jejunum, correct?
Yes, sir.
So, I know that you have seen, but you have not checked what is the needle like. You know that it is round body. Why round body?
Sir, so that the delicate organ, delicate mucosa is not damaged. If we take a cutting needle, then it might tear off.
Correct. Very nice. So you have completed 4-layer anastomosis. Anything else that you saw being done?
Sir, the entire stomach was not anastomosed to the jejunum. Part of the stomach was closed primarily.
Okay. What is the angle of sorrow?
Not sure, sir.
Not sure. Does not matter. No, particularly, you said part of the stomach was closed and the then gastrojejunostomy. So I ask you this question. What is angle of sorrow? Go back and read. Angle of sorrow is the junction. between the closed stomach and that junction where the jejunum and the closed stomach takes place, that is known as, that is the one which can leak. And that used to be the fear in a surgeon's mind, and that's why it was known as angle of sorrow. Okay, I think, I don't know how much time you want to pull on with the first candidate.
Anything else? Anything else can be done, sir, asked, except the partial close, partially anastomose and then completely anastomose, particularly when patient is little hypoalbuminic. Anything else will you like?
Will you add a jejunostomy in this patient? Yes.
Very simple.
Yes, sir, I'll add a feeding jejunostomy for the patient.
Now tell me, how is jejunostomy done?
The feeding jejunostomy may be done in two ways. In one, in which we create a tunnel.
Very good.
And what anastomosis. Sorry, anyway, anastomosis.
Whose name?
Witzel.
Witzel, very good. And the second one is stem, right?
Yes. Where we directly anastomose without creating a tunnel.
What is the size of the Ryle's cube that you use in a jejunostomy?
We usually use a larger 18 or 20 French, but
my last question to you, how will you teach the relative care of jejunostomy?
Sir, whenever they provide some amount of a diet or food or anything, in the end they have to give 50 ml of saline to just flush the tube.
Ghar mein kidhar se laayega re bhaiya?
Any water. Any water, they have to just flush it.
You have to flush and see that it is patent.
Yes.
Okay. Patient, 1 month down the line, comes back to you saying that jejunostomy is blocked. Now, what will you do?
Sir, we will try to flush it with some amount of saline. And
1 month later on. So, what question will you ask?
When was the last feed that was given? After the last feed, whether water was given or not?
Water wo jata nahi tha, nahi, it was not going, doctor. That's why I brought him here. Now, how will you try to open up that block?
I'll try to push it with some saline with some amount of force. I'll try to check the bulb whether it has been. I'll check the bulb whether it is hyperinflated or not.
Which bulb?
You are talking of Foley's, sir. He's talking of Ryle's tube.
No, I never brought in Foley's. He said 18 to 20 number.
Now he's talking of Foley's.
Now he's talking of Foley's. That means he's already changed it to Foley's, which I'm not going to allow him.
Yes.
How big is your house, Veer? How big is your house?
3 bedrooms, sir.
3 bedrooms, very good. Any of the bathroom or wash basin gets clogged, what do you do?
Sir, I think you should give the answer to him, sir. He is not into the line.
He might, if it is still not possible, as 4 weeks have occurred, we might change the Ryle's tube as the tract is already established.
That is one. What ingredient you can use to flush?
Something to foam the content, foam and clear.
Baking soda, suna hai kya baking soda?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You inject baking soda solution and most of the times this block will go away because of the effervescence that it creates.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And the first question, whether he's taking proper diet or not, if he's taking, you may think to remove it.
Remove it. Anyway, Kanakwell, you go on.
Let me ask you to move on to the next case, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Veer. From my side.
Yes, sir. You're okay.
I'll pass you.
Yes,
but you have to tell me that you worked in the ward properly. Yeah?
Yes, sir.
If I really come as examiner, please be very careful. You have to know what needle is used in suturing. I don't want to know classification of this.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
See, the policies of feeding jejunostomies are very simple and clear. If you are not confident about your anastomosis of your duodenal stump, especially when you do a subtotal gastrectomy, feeding jejunostomy is indicated, right? the most important message you have to tell to the attenders or to the patient when you do a feeding jejunostomy is, at the end of every feed, even it can be a liquid feed or whatever, the tube has to be flushed with a minimum of 20 to 30 ml of normal tap water. That is mandatory. They may say, sir, I gave only juice, I gave only milk, does not matter. It is mandatory you instruct the patient and the attender, every feed, immaterial of whatever be the time, has to be flushed, the entire tube length, what is outside and what is inside the intestinal lumen, which is the minimum mandate of 30 centimeter of your tube, whatever we need to use, have to be used. And number two, for the benefit of postgraduates, people and in the center where they use Foley's catheter for doing a feeding jejunostomy, please, for heaven's sake, do not inflate the bulb. Very important. And then at this point of time, yeah, 10 to 12 size catheter is advocated. We don't definitely go for 18 or 20 because the complications of feeding jejunostomy in a bigger tube are more. Then the policy of removing a feeding jejunostomy depends on your post-operative surgical pathology report. If the patient for any reason warrant a post-operative systemic therapy, you wait for a minimum mandate of 2 or 3 cycles for your RILS tube to go. Because these patients can end up having vomiting as a perineal problem of chemotherapy. So feeding jejunostomy has to be waited before you remove. Even there is no requirement for feeding jejunostomy, you allow till the third cycle of chemotherapy to be over, because most of the time your first chemotherapy can be toxic. But if you cross 3 cycles, generally after that your tolerance of chemotherapy is fairly good. All right. And then if you are doing a total gastrectomy, if your margins are positive microscopically, whatever be the adjuvant therapy, please do not remove your feeding jejunostomy tube. Because your survival or your tumor-free, disease-free survival is not going to be long, especially if your margins are positive. So patients, feeding access is the only source of nutrition for the, your FJ is the only nutritional source. All right. So keep these things in mind. And may have one last question. Can you quickly list out the post gastrectomy complications?
Yes, sir. So there can be the initial dumping syndrome, which is seen. It can be early dumping or a late dumping. There is efferent loop syndrome, bile reflux.
Just let me hold on you. We don't have much time. Whenever you are asked for a complication, you please discuss on-table complications, immediate post-operative complications, and late complications. Please have an order when you answer the questions, right? So that way, the examiners will appreciate your logical approach and your systematic approach will definitely get through, even if you have not done well in the other parts. Any answer for the matter, you have a system to answer.
Yes.
All right. Considering this, what will be the on-table troubles you may face during a gastrectomy?
Sir, there can be hemorrhage, which can occur. There can be damage to surrounding structures, which can occur.
Which are the more troublesome hemorrhages you have seen during a gastrectomy?
I have not seen any such hemorrhage during a gastrectomy.
Okay, post-operatively, can you get hemorrhage, if at all? If you get from where you are expecting to get a hemorrhage?
On the...
Is there a drain for the distal gastrectomy in your department?
Yes.
Okay, where do you place the tip of the drain tube?
One in Morrison's pouch and second in pelvis.
You place 2 drains. Perfect. So if you are going to get bleeding from your Morrison's pouch drain, what are the concerns you have?
Gastroduodenal stump. Stump of the gastroduodenal artery.
That comes much later, na? You mean to say bleeding from the stump?
Yes. Bleeding from the anastomotic site.
That is usually through the nasogastric tube, right? It should not be through the drain tube, right? When you have an anastomotic site bleeding, it should be from your nasogastric tube. So the color of the nasogastric tube in the postoperative period do matter. initial blood staining is accepted as a normal condition when you do a gastrointestinal anastomosis or a jejunoesophageal anastomosis. But in the postoperative period, if it looks more of bloody discharge from the rile tube, you are definitely concerned. Leave alone that. Then, in the first 3-4 days of period, what are the most important complications pertaining to abdomen? I don't want respiratory and other thing. Pertaining to the surgery, what are the troubles you may face?
There can be a infection of the wound, collection in the abdomen. There can be a duodenal stump blowout, which can occur. There can
what
be...
What is the most common trouble you may face up in the post-operative period? I understand what these are all the potential complications you may face. Patient may say, I'm still... Your junior will say, sir, rile tube is about 1200 ml. And by day before yesterday, it was 800 ml. Yesterday, it is 1200 ml. Today, it is 1500 ml. Are delayed, you concerned about this?
Delayed gastric emptying or ileus?
Yes. So especially when you're dealing with the totally dyselectrolyteemic patient, you have to be careful in the immediate postoperative period also. That should be the immediate consideration. To quickly wrap up, can you list the delayed complications of gastric emptying?
Yes, sir. So there is a dumping syndrome. There can be early dumping syndrome or a late dumping syndrome. There can be an efferent loop syndrome. There can be an efferent loop syndrome. There can be a bile reflux. And there can be anemia, which can be due to iron deficiency or folate deficiency. There can be calcium vitamin D deficiency. There can be ulcer that can occur at the anastomotic site.
Okay, so that sounds good. So I think you did a fairly good presentation. But then, no, you plan your answer, right? You seem to be in an urgency to tell the answers. So you take a time for you to assimilate the question, right? I am sure you have read a lot. But then when you answer, unless it is, as Professor Andaria said, if it is not going to resolve the question what the examiner is asking you, then the point of you rattling out subject not be relevant at all here in your exam. You may end up telling, sir, I ended up answering all the questions, still I have not gone through. So unless the examiners have very clear policy, they discuss in the morning whenever they see the case itself, what are the potential areas. Most of the time examiners ask, if most of the time two or three candidates may examine a single case, the questions will be more or less same for all the candidates. Most of the time, examiners concur to the finding, concur to the questions well in ahead, right? So, unless you are comfortable in assimilating a question and answering, then it definitely does not give you a very comfortable feel when you finish the exam, right? Go back, your one textbook reading will not be sufficient, especially when you go towards your exam. I would appreciate you have to read a little bit of textbook, little book of NCCN, little book of specialized textbooks also will help. This should be the right approach. I would say you start writing notes for all the long cases. Today, you have opened up so many areas by the examiners where you feel a little uncomfortable. I could appreciate where are your lacuna. Sit back. You can listen to this presentation. It's going to be on the YouTube forever. Please sit back and identify the area of lacunae and then fresh up those areas. That is all. All of us have come through your stage, so it is nothing wrong. Please go back, see the video again, see the presentation where all you had difficulty. And there have been few comments from the other examiners who are not part of the teaching today, that you are running through your presentation rapidly, right? You go a little slow when you present, because the examiner has to follow your finding in a logical manner, or else they may end up asking you the question that you have told. You should have very clear pauses between findings, either positive or negative, especially positive EST and relevant negative EST. Let's see, assimilating. Patient gives EST of GI bleeding, or patient gives EST of melina. Patient gives EST of induced vomiting. Patient gives EST of induced vomiting. That does not matter. That does not drive the message. Patient gives EST of induced vomiting. Then you describe about what is the induced vomiting type this patient is having. Patient ball rolling movement. Up there. bowel rolling movement is present all through the day or on taking food, what brings the bowel rolling movement and what relieves the bowel rolling movement? So there should be a pause in between your lines that makes the examiner to understand your confidence. Right? So that will be few examiner tips. May I request Dr. Anandi Madam, Ganesh Babu sir, and Abhay sir, and G.V. Prakash sir to give the closing remarks before we go to the next case.
Thank you, Kanakavel. I'm audible?
Yes, sir. Very well, sir.
Yeah. I went through the discussion part. Dr. Visha done very well in the theoretical discussion part. At the very early set, there's a lot of lacunae in the clinical history taking. He's not mentioned points about early satiety, which is the symptom which for the coming to diagnosis of malignancy. Coming to the clinical diagnosis, stuck only the malignancy part, though the lump is huge in size, is unlikely to have a cholesteroma of stomach present such a vast size of the lump. He should have considered that differential diagnosis. And coming to findings, he's not mentioned anything about VGP, which type, and he's not very clear about, I didn't follow the, what the description about the suction splash. It's difficult to accept such huge lump producing a suction splash. So these are the few lacunae presentation. The rest of the findings, fine, okay.
Thank you.
Veer,
yes,
your presentation was very good and you are prepared well. Only thing is, you are so hurried and you are listening to the examiner so keenly. If you listen what really they want, probably you will be able to answer all. I feel that you have read a lot and you know answers. You are in a hurry to answer immediately. Don't try to answer like a robot. Just once you receive questions, don't answer immediately. Wait, sit and just think for 2-3 seconds, then revert back. That will be the best thing for you to come out of exam without any issue. All the best.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you,
sir.
Madam.
Veer, Visha,
yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I think you did a good job of presenting well. I was not there when you were presenting. I heard from others that you went through a rapid phase. But otherwise, you answered the questions, everything pretty good. Remember that in a case of a CS stomach, usually the presentation would be either as a mass or it might be as a metastatic symptoms or with a outlet obstruction. These are the three things usually they will present as. When there is going to be a metastatic thing, you think the patient treatment is going to be palliation. Okay, if it's not going to be metastatic, then you can go ahead and think about whether it's going to have any other additional other things, and then you can go ahead and do the surgery. That is the main thing you have to remember. When there is a metastasis, you think about palliation. When there's going to be an involvement of the adjacent structures, think about of neoadjuvant chemotherapy and then going for surgery. So these two things you have to keep in your mind. Otherwise, it was a good presentation, and I enjoyed everybody's questioning. And thank you, Kanagavir.
Thank you, ma'am.
Dr. Jayalal, sir, please.
I was just watching this, but it is excellent. The candidate is relatively presenting well. The findings are very good, but he needs to study a little what is updated. What is the even like drop metastasis and the transulomic metastasis? They are not now almost outdated. Even for Kurkenberg tumor, it is the lymphatic spread is much more importantly they are giving and not the things. And Kanavel has very rightly pointed out about the cytology, and when the cytology is not going to determine the our modality of treatment based on if it is no macroscopic finding is there. But this is a very good constellation of ideas which come from especially Abhay Dalvi sir as very, very pungent in asking these questions, and I'm sure that it will motivate the students to look for the very practical tips when they are coming out with the presenting the cases, and that always delineate whether they are working in the ward or not. It is a very good effort which Kanavel sir is doing, and we congratulate the candidate and all the faculties for an excellent coordination of this.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Andariya, sir, you give your closing remarks before we move to the next case.
I think I have told Veer many a times that just to listen to the question, he has to understand what examiner is expecting, and he has to lead the examiner the way he knows the subject, not the other way around. Say for example, he's starting with some uncommon causes, so where he can be trapped. He obviously what he knows. Example, father, right? Dalvi sir, like examiner, ask the teacher what you are trying to show. So make sure your answering is justifiable, rational, and related to the common causes.
Finally, remarks.
Yes, thank you, sir.
Pertaining to the cases.
Thank you so much, sir. Vivekananda Subramanian, your final words, please.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much for all the faculties. Sir, Dr. Vishwa, you have done well. But one thing, in the examination, you have to slowly present. Don't fast. Your presentation good. Answer is good. Better give the answer to the questions. Unnecessary, don't give a chance to the examiners. So this is for a related to the examination point of view. Anyway, you have done well. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Nisha. Can you please mute yourself? Now we move on to the case. One senior professor by name Roop Kumar Karabadi is there with us in the line. Sir, can you please identify yourself? I'm not sure which college you are from, sir. Professor Roop Kumar? Okay, fine. He is
yes, sir.
Sir, Abhidalvi, sir, can we move to the next case?
Yeah,